little bit of snow, which is really a present for me, and I really appreciate all you make it today. Mm-hmm. So before I start, to read you one of my favorite quotes that I found when I was preparing for this topic. Expressive behavior may be one of the most sensitive and reliable indicators of cultural patterns and social structure. Apparently, as people leave, so do they see. This is my, as I mentioned, this is my favorite quote from one of the profound ethnomusicologists, Aldo Lomax, who did a lot of research and collecting work on folk music. Throughout human history, music has played an important role in forming and shaping the culture. Music can be seen as a reflection of a community. It mirrors human history, values, and mentality of a society. And it also acts as an important role in shaping the culture. For today, we will be looking at spirituals. It shares the similar character as folk music in Western music. They both massively carry the direct culture influence of their contemporary. Oftentimes, it's linked with the text as well. Due to their simplicity and anonymity, many folkloric songs are often lack of attention or not being taken seriously. Today, I will be focusing on spirituals by introducing one of its advocate figures, Harry T. Burleigh, and his relationship with both spirituals and art songs. Harry T. Burleigh is one of the leading advocates of African-American culture and spirituals. Burleigh believes that artistic solo setting of spirituals would enhance their appeal and increase their popularity. In other words, which means transforming the spiritual into an art song setting that fits more into the classical staging. Here's a quote from Harry T. Burleigh. In the old forms, the spirituals were just simply tunes. They don't have a complement. It has been in print for years, but it's only since they were arranged into an art song form they have become widely known. Most of the people first know this name, Harry T. Burleigh, from his arrangement of Deep River. Here we will hear a little bit about Deep River. Spirituals came from his grandfather, Hamilton Waters, who was an escaped slave from Somerset County, Maryland. It is believed that Burleigh was freely exposed to spirituals and other folk music during his youth. His grandfather would sing plantation songs while he's working around Burleigh. Plantation songs is also known as slave songs. It is a type of song came from a dark human history of enslavement. Music was a way for slaves to express their feeling, whether it's for sorrow, joy, inspiration, or hope. Songs were passed down from generation to generation throughout slavery. These songs were influenced by African and religious traditions and later become the basis for what is known today as spirituals. He also wrote a few vocal and instrumental works based on plantation melodies he had learned as a child. However, his most well one that you just heard, is considered the first work of that genre to be written in the form of art songs, specifically for a concert hall performance. Harry T. Burleigh was born on December 2, 1866 in Erie, Pennsylvania, and died on September 12, 1949 in Stamford, Connecticut. Though he had no formal music education as a child, he had opportunities to hear performances of visiting artists, and that inspired him to become a singer, and I believe he sings as a baritone. He found work in Erie singing in local churches. At the age of 26, he competed for a scholarship at the National Conservatory of Music in New York City, and he won the scholarship. When DeVorter came to New York teaching in that conservatory, Burleigh was one of his students. Sadly, the scholarship that Burleigh received, it can only support his tuition, so he had to work to pay for his living. Because of that, he works at the conservatory. I think in today's world, it might be a janitor in school. So he did the same thing as his grandfather. He sings the spirituals while he's working. And Dvorak was attracted by the charming tunes, so he encouraged Burleigh to introduce him more about the spirituals. And because of that connection, they had a lot of musical exchange, and that becomes one of the inspiration for Dvorak to compose New World Symphony. Burleigh realized that from Dvorak, because Dvorak was trying to encourage him to devote more time in spirituals. So he realized that African-American folk song could be part of the basis of American culture, and this has become his lifelong goal. Dvorak once said, "The future of this country must be founded upon what are called," bear with my language, "Negro melodies," this is his quote. "This must be the real foundation of any serious and original school of composition to be developed in the United States." Essentially, it's a radical way for Dvorak to tell Americans that the future of American music has long been destroyed and suppressed because of the history, and because spirituals were considered, back then, were considered as not cultured or not high class enough, so that's why it's not being revealed at the time. But obviously, the time changed right now, so it's not the same. Burleigh started to publish his own art songs in the 1890s, which is earlier than his spiritual arrangements. Through the 1920s and 1930s, Burleigh started to promote the spirituals through publications, lectures, arrangements, and he is really well known with his arrangements of spirituals more than his art songs. Burleigh is indeed one of the pioneers of arranging or transforming spirituals into an artistic format which fits to a concert hall. But around 1920, with the Harlem Renaissance, there are criticism from both white American and African American pointing out that the arrangements from Burleigh might have been missing the oral tradition by adding sophisticated structure, which means the art song structure, because original spirituals don't have any accompaniments. Basically saying that Burleigh over-sophisticated the spirituals, it also pulls spirituals away from its originality. So here I would like to play one of the spirituals, Go Down Moses, in two versions. One is from Louis Armstrong. He's one of the famous figure in that time during the Harlem Renaissance, and he's well known. One is his arrangement, and the other one is the arrangement from Harry T. Burleigh, so we can compare two different types.
Go down, Moses! Wait! so hard they could not stand.
Let my people go.
So the Lord said, go down.
Go down.
Moses.
Moses.
Way down,
down
in Egypt.
Okay, so sorry to interrupt, but now we're back to the classical time. So a reclaiming African-American culture, so it favors of the originality and the primitive version of any kinds of art. Therefore, Burleigh's spirituals is targeted as losing the essence of the spirituals because it's over-sophisticated. According to Jen Snyder's article, some commented Burleigh gave us a kind of idealist spirituals, a transformation of the melodies into art songs, very much in the manner of Brahms German Lieder. This is a quote from a well-known philosopher and art patron, Alan Locke. He said, "Folk art is always despised and rejected at first, but generations after, it flowers again and transcends the level of its origin." He valued and credited Mr. Burleigh's vision and courage to proclaim spirituals' value and possibilities by transforming the spirituals into art songs. If we see this as an evolution of spirituals, then perhaps we can see Harriet Burleigh, his arrangements as the first stage of the process. Because of his effort and contribution, we have opportunities to see more possible ways to present spirituals and promote it. But because of this contradiction, we can also sense that Harriet Burleigh has embodied a strong art song structure into his spiritual arrangements. Here's some of his well-known spiritual arrangements. At the end of his life, Burleigh expressed regret that his many art songs had not earned as much as attention as spirituals arrangements. But of course, he's satisfied and happy by the growing popularity of his arrangements. Here are some of his other art song cycles. He also have a lot of single art songs. Passionale is another his well-known art song cycle. It was written around 1915. It's the same time period as the song cycle that I will be presenting today, Five Songs of Laurence. It is said that Burleigh is more known of his arrangements of spirituals. Until recent years, his art songs are gradually getting more attention. Today, I would like to present his art song cycle, Five Songs of Laurence. There's, as the title, there's five songs. Worthwhile, The Jungle Flower, Kashmir Song, Among the Fuchsias, Till I Wake. Among these five songs, the last one, Till I Wake, is the most famous one. During the premiere of this song, it was requested by the audience to be repeated as an encore. Now, we have to talk about the poet, Laurence Hope. Laurence Hope, this name is actually the pseudonym of English poet Edward immigrated with her father to India since she was a child. Then she married with the Colonel Malcolm Nicholson, who stationed us various places throughout India and other countries. They have lived in India, Africa, and London. Eventually, they moved back to India's destination of their life. Interestingly, Nicholson published all of her works under this male pen name, Laurence. In 1901, she published Garden of Kama, which was published a year later in America under the title India's Love Lyrics. The third song of the cycle, Kashmir Song, is from this collection. Composer Amy Woodford Fenton also set music for this poem in 1902. So based on the timeline here, we can see she's actually quite successful back then because her poem set with music so quick after it was published. Interestingly, she tried to hide her true identity as a poet for these works. So she pretended that these are translations of various poets. But it's very suspicious from the reader because of her unique writing. Her poems are typically about known result love, lost, and the death that followed unhappy affairs. Because of her romantic style and exotic setting, her works became popular very quickly. Two of her other books, Stars of Desert and Indian Love, were also well received. Here's the poem, Till I Awake. By reading the poem, we can see, we can sense a little of her central words and how appealing her language are. Five Songs of Laurence Hope is also known as Hope Songs. It's premiered on March 19, 1916 by Irish tenor John McCormick, along with pianist Adam Schneider. The performance was well received. As I mentioned before, the audience request last song, Till I Awake, was repeated. 2 weeks after, they performed The Jungle Flower, Worthwhile, and Till I Awake again. Most of the reviews commenting his gift of melody and successful suggestion of the Oriental atmosphere. This is a review from Boston Evening Transcript, saying that this whole songs should be considered as Harriet Burleigh's best work. And there's more reviews about this song cycle. It's all saying the same that consider this work as his best work, and it's also a proof that his ability and talent on art songs. There's a reason I choose this set, because I love this set, so I really hope that I can present this set in my lecture recital. These songs are, they all have a very nice prelude gestures provided by piano. A nice lift before the first singing phrase. You can hear a lot of abrupt key changes, surprising accidentals, diminished 7th and 9th chords. According to the article from Journal of Singing by Grigory Zavrecki, he called this special chords Burleigh chords, like I marked it in the purple. Here's an example for that. So we will hear a little bit, just that phrase. Song among the fuchsia. If you can see, there's a little purple that I quoted wrong, this word. You can see there's so many accidental there. And actually, we both spent a lot of time to figure out how to phrase that chord and how to fit in, because the harmony is so unique and the word is so appealing. Another interesting thing that mutual partnership. Here's an example for the second song. So we'll hear the very beginning, and then we'll compare that to the end. This is in the same song, the second song, Jungle Flowers. Oh, I'm sorry. So I would also like to mention the amount of grace notes in this. This is example, a great example from the beginning. You can see a lot of grace notes on the left hand. I took a little time to figure out how to address that and how to play that, because in the classical music, we tend to avoid the crunchy sound that we try to make everything smooth, especially on piano. We don't want anything dissonant. But Bryson helped me a lot to figure out actually there's a different style, different language to present this instead of using our traditional classical music approach. There's a lot of dissonance, there's a lot of freedom inside the music that it's not traditional. It's not the way that we train as a classical musician. And throughout our rehearsals, Bryson and I talk a lot about the style, and there's a lot of different elements in this piece, so I hope you would like this piece as much as I like it, and I think you can see how talented and how creative Mr. Burleigh is throughout the song. Here's my conclusion. As a collaborator, it's very important to carry and provide the atmosphere for vocalists, especially for vocalists, within prelude and postlude. In this set, the prelude, postlude, and even some very expressive interlude of each song present a strong character as preparation, conclusion, or even extension of the theme. Throughout the songs, the tension and the climax are built up together between two parts. The special color, really needs two parts, which means the piano parts and the vocal parts blended together to create a very special color and harmony. And that comes from the mutual understanding of the piece and well communication between two parts. It is really quite fun to work with a set like this that needs so much energy equally from both parts. This set will present Burleigh's excellent writing in art song setting and his capability to fuse different styles into one. Even though Burleigh is one of the well-known African-American composers, and a lot of his arrangements of spirituals have been performed, but his own art songs are not under people's radar until recent year. I found his work lately because I was searching for African-American composer's work, and I just deeply fall in love with this set. And we will try our best to present this music for you today, and hope you enjoyed it. Thank you for listening. We'll take a 5 minutes break. Let me adjust the seat because the performance will be there. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.